Your textbook looks like a rainbow threw up on it. And somehow you think that's studying. Here's what nobody tells you about those perfectly highlighted pages and color-coded notes that make you feel so productive. The research is absolutely shocking. Highlighting doesn't just fail to help your memory, it actually makes retention worse. We've all been there, convincing ourselves that beautiful notes equal beautiful grades. The University of Colorado studied thousands of students and found that highlighters create what psychologists call the illusion of knowing. Your brain sees the bright colors and thinks, "I've got this covered," while learning absolutely nothing. Picture this absurdity. You spend more time choosing highlighter colors than actually thinking about the content. We treat our textbooks like coloring books and wonder why we forget everything by exam time. The cruel irony? Every highlighted sentence becomes invisible to your brain. You're literally training yourself to ignore the information you think you're emphasizing. This isn't your fault. You've been lied to about what effective studying looks like. The colorful, organized, aesthetically pleasing study methods that feel productive are designed for Instagram, not learning. But here's the good news. Once you understand how your brain actually works, you unlock a new level of control. Chapter 1. Your brain isn't broken. Your methods are. Your brain is like a nightclub bouncer, very selective about who gets in and very quick to kick people out. Here's what the research actually shows. Your working memory, the conscious part of your brain that processes new information, can only handle about 7 pieces of information at once. That's it. 7 plus or minus 2. Every student I've ever met tries to cram dozens of concepts into a space designed for 7. It's like trying to park 20 cars in a 7-space parking lot. Something's got to give, and usually it's your sanity. The problem runs deeper. Your brain processes conscious attention at roughly 120 bits per second. Just listening to someone speak requires 60 bits. Do the math. You're already using half your processing power just to hear these words. This explains why multitasking while studying is like trying to text while performing surgery. Your brain literally cannot do both well. What feels like multitasking is actually rapid task switching, and each switch costs you focus and memory. That moment when you realize you've been working against your brain's natural design instead of with it. There's a better way. And it starts with understanding that your brain isn't broken. Your methods are. Chapter 2. The forgetting curve is eating your knowledge. Your memories have the lifespan of a TikTok trend. Here for a moment, viral for a second, gone forever. Hermann Ebbinghaus discovered something terrifying about human memory over a century ago. Pay attention to this. You forget 50% of new information within 1 hour. Let that sink in. Half of everything you just studied vanishes before you finish your coffee. By tomorrow, you've lost 70%. By next week, you remember less than 10%. It gets worse. The forgetting curve is exponential, meaning the loss accelerates. Your brain treats most new information like spam. Interesting for a moment, then immediately deleted to make room for more important things, like remembering where you put your keys. Here's the kicker. Timing beats duration every single time. Studying something for 1 hour today and reviewing it for 10 minutes tomorrow creates more lasting memory than studying for 2 hours straight. We organize our Spotify playlists better than our study sessions, and somehow expect our brains to perform like a perfectly curated algorithm. The forgetting curve isn't your enemy. It's your teacher. Here's exactly what to do. Fight back at exactly the right moments. Review within 24 hours, then again in 3 days, then a week later. This rewires how you think. You're not forgetting because you're not smart enough. You're forgetting because you're not timing it right. Chapter 3. Active recall. Make your brain do push-ups. Stop feeding your brain. Make it hunt for food. This might sound crazy, but the harder you make learning feel, the easier remembering becomes. Active recall is like CrossFit for your memory. Uncomfortable in the moment, incredibly powerful over time. Instead of reading your notes for the 100th time, close the book and write down everything you remember. You'll feel stupid at first. That feeling means it's working. The science proves this works. Students who use active recall retain 50% more information than those who just reread material. The struggle to remember literally strengthens the neural pathways. Picture this scenario. You're studying for a history exam. Instead of highlighting dates and names, you cover the page and quiz yourself. What happened in 1776? Who was involved? Why did it matter? Each failed attempt to remember makes the eventual, correct answer stick better. Making mistakes is like CrossFit for your memory. The burn means you're building strength. Here's exactly what to do. Read a section, close the book, write everything you remember on a blank page. Don't peek. Struggle with it. Check your accuracy. Repeat. You can start this today. Your brain is already stronger than you think. You just need to make it prove it. Speaking of making your brain prove it, here's something that completely changed how I think about learning, and it connects perfectly to today's sponsor, Brilliant. You know how I just talked about active recall being like CrossFit for your memory? Well, I realized most of us were never taught how to actually think through problems. We just learned to follow steps and memorize formulas. That's exactly why traditional studying fails. This video is sponsored by Brilliant. Brilliant helps you get smarter every day. With thousands of interactive lessons in math, science, programming, data analysis, and AI. But here's what makes it different from every other learning platform I've tried. Brilliant builds your critical thinking skills through hands-on problem solving, not memorizing formulas. Every lesson lets you play with concepts, which research shows is 6 times more effective than watching lectures. So while you're learning specific topics, you're also becoming a better thinker overall. Take their newly updated math courses. They help you discover algebra you can already do but haven't realized yet, which is exactly what active recall does for your memory. They strengthen your logical reasoning with the perfect level of challenge, building mathematical intuition through visuals that make concepts actually click. It's the kind of learning environment that actually develops your thinking rather than just testing your memory. Plus, it's designed to build that daily learning habit that's the opposite of mindless scrolling, exactly what we need for spaced repetition to work. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, and also get 20% off an annual premium subscription, visit brilliant.org/productivepeter or scan the QR code on screen. Chapter 4, Spaced Repetition, the Memory Time Machine. Your brain loves surprises, especially pop quizzes from itself. Here's what blew my mind. Reviewing something tomorrow is more powerful than reviewing it today. The magic happens in the spacing, not the studying. Hermann Ebbinghaus didn't just discover the forgetting curve, he found the antidote. The research is crystal clear. Information reviewed at increasing intervals creates permanent memory. Think of your brain like a muscle. You don't build strength by lifting weights every day. You build it by challenging the muscle just as it starts to recover. Memory works the same way. The optimal spacing intervals sound almost magical. Review after 1 day, then 3 days, then 1 week, then 2 weeks, then 1 month. Each review should happen just as you're about to forget. The irony is perfect. We cram everything together and wonder why nothing sticks when the secret is spreading it apart. Modern spaced repetition software like Anki has turned this into a science. The algorithm knows exactly when you're about to forget and surfaces the information at the perfect moment. You'll feel the difference immediately. Information that used to slip away will become permanently accessible. It's like having a memory upgrade installed in your brain. Chapter 5. The Testing Effect. Your best friend in disguise. Making mistakes is your brain's favorite teacher, even though it feels like your worst enemy. This blew my mind. Failed tests improve learning more than successful studying. When you struggle to retrieve information and get it wrong, your brain pays attention in a way that passive reading never achieves. Every student I've ever met treats testing like judgment day instead of learning day. But research from cognitive psychology shows that the act of testing literally rewrites your neural pathways. Picture this transformation. Instead of dreading tests, you create them for yourself. After reading a chapter, you write questions that would challenge someone else. Then you answer them without looking back. The struggle is the signal. When you can't remember something, your brain is telling you exactly what needs attention. Self-testing reveals the illusion of knowledge. We've all been there. Thinking we know something until we try to explain it or write it down. Testing forces honesty. Here's exactly what to do. After every study session, create 5 questions that would stump your past self. Answer them. Grade yourself honestly. Focus your next session on what you missed. The transformation begins when you start seeing wrong answers as treasure maps pointing to your next breakthrough. Join our YouTube membership and get exclusive perks like early access to scripts, input on future topics about productivity, and connect with a like-minded community that gets it. Click join below and let's build your easier, more intentional life together. Chapter 6. Interleaving. Confuse your way to clarity. Your brain is like a DJ. It works better when mixing tracks than playing the same song on repeat. This might sound backwards, but mixing different types of problems in a single study session improves performance on all of them. It's called interleaving, and it's the opposite of what most people do. We organize our study sessions like Netflix genres. All math, then all history, then all science. But your brain learns better when you shuffle the playlist. The research is fascinating. Students who practice mixed problem sets outperform those who practice in blocks, even though blocked practice feels easier in the moment. Here's why it works. When you switch between different types of problems, your brain has to actively choose the right strategy each time. This strengthens both understanding and flexibility. Think about real life. Exams don't come with labels saying, "This is a calculus problem," or "This is a physics problem." Your brain needs practice recognizing which tool to use and when. You can start this today. Instead of studying algebra for 2 hours straight, spend 20 minutes on algebra, 20 on geometry, 20 on statistics, then repeat. It feels messy at first, but that confusion is your brain building stronger, more flexible connections. Chapter 7. The Feynman Technique. Explain like you're five. If you can't explain it to a rubber duck, you don't really know it. Richard Feynman, the Nobel Prize-winning physicist, had a simple test for understanding. Can you explain this concept to a child? Not because children are simple, but because complex jargon often hides fuzzy thinking. We've all been there, using big words to sound smart while having no idea what we're actually saying. The Feynman technique forces brutal honesty about what you actually understand. Here's exactly how it works. Pick a concept you're studying. Imagine you're teaching it to someone who's never heard of it before. Use simple words, no jargon, no shortcuts. Something magic happens in the struggle. When you can't find simple words to explain something, you found exactly where your understanding breaks down. Teaching reveals what you don't know. Every time you stumble trying to explain something, your brain is showing you a gap that needs filling. The transformation is immediate. Complex ideas become clear when you're forced to build them from simple parts. You stop memorizing and start understanding. You can practice this anywhere. Explain concepts to friends, family, or even your pet. The more confused they look, the more work you have to do. Chapter 8. Environment design. Your space is your mind. Your study spot has more influence than your study buddy, and most people never even think about it. This will surprise you. Your brain creates stronger memories when you study in multiple locations than when you stick to one perfect spot. Context-dependent learning means your environment becomes part of the memory. Students who studied word lists in two different rooms remembered 40% more than those who studied in one room twice. Your brain uses location as a memory cue. We optimize our bedrooms for sleep, but never optimize our study spaces for learning. Temperature, lighting, noise levels, and even smell all impact cognitive performance. Here's what actually works. Cool temperatures keep you alert. Natural light reduces eye strain and improves focus. Consistent background noise can enhance concentration, but only if it's truly consistent. The clutter on your desk creates clutter in your mind. Your brain processes visual chaos as cognitive load, leaving less mental energy for actual learning. But here's the real secret. Changing your study location periodically strengthens memory recall. Study history in the library, review it at home, test yourself in a coffee shop. Your environment is your silent study partner. Make sure it's working with you, not against you. Chapter 9. Sleep, the ultimate study hack. Your brain does its best work when you're unconscious, which explains a lot about my college years. Your pillow consolidates more memories than your notes. While you sleep, your brain literally rewires itself, transferring information from temporary storage to permanent memory. Students who sleep after learning perform 40% better on tests than those who stay awake. Sleep isn't rest from learning. It's when learning actually happens. Here's what your brain does while you're dreaming. It replays the day's experiences up to 20 times faster than real time, strengthening the neural pathways that matter and pruning the ones that don't. We treat all-nighters like badges of honor, when they're actually badges of inefficiency. One night of poor sleep can undo a week of good studying. The timing matters too. Sleep within 12 hours of learning something important. Your brain has a limited window for memory consolidation. Even naps are powerful. A 20-minute nap after studying can improve retention by 34%. Your brain doesn't need 8 hours to start the consolidation process. Sleep is not a luxury when you're learning. It's the most important study tool you have. Chapter 10, Building Your Personal Study Operating System. Your brain is as unique as your Netflix recommendations. So why would you use someone else's study system? This is where everything comes together. You've learned the techniques that work. Now, you need to build a system that works for you. Some people are morning learners. Others think more clearly at midnight. Some need complete silence. Others focus better with background noise. The key is honest self-assessment, not following trends. Here's how to find your optimal system. Track your energy levels throughout the day for 1 week. Notice when you feel most alert, most creative, most able to focus. Your chronotype is your learning superpower. Design your environment around your discoveries. If you focus better with music, create specific playlists for different types of learning. If you think better while moving, find ways to study while walking. The best system is the one you'll actually use. Complexity is the enemy of consistency. Start simple, then optimize. Build in review cycles that feel natural. If you check social media every morning, stack spaced repetition flashcards right before. If you drink coffee every afternoon, use that time for active recall practice. You're not just building study habits. You're building a learning operating system that will serve you for life. Graduation is just the tutorial ending. The real game starts now. The best learners never stop being beginners. They maintain curiosity, embrace confusion, and see every challenge as a chance to upgrade their mental software. Here's what separates lifelong learners from everyone else. They don't just learn information, they learn how to learn better. Every study session becomes an experiment in optimization. The world is changing faster than ever. The half-life of learned skills is shrinking. What you know matters less than how quickly you can learn what you need to know next. But you're already ahead of 95% of people. Most adults stop actively learning the day they graduate. You now have tools that can accelerate your learning for decades. Keep experimenting. Try new techniques. Track what works. Abandon what doesn't. Your learning system should evolve as you evolve. Remember the transformation you've already made. You started this video studying the wrong way. You're finishing it with evidence-based methods that can change everything. The future belongs to learners, and now you know how to learn. Your journey from student to lifelong learner starts now. And hey, if you like this video, don't forget to subscribe and hit that like button. Also, let me know your thoughts on what I just shared. Oh, and there's more. I've just started a Patreon to help support these videos and connect with you more directly. Check out the link in the description if you'd like to join.